In this lesson, we will talk about the photoelectric effect, which is one of the key phenomena that led to the development of quantum mechanics. Photoelectric effect refers to the ejection of electrons from a metal surface when we shine light on it. Illustrated here is an apparatus used to study the photoelectric effect. Two metal plates are placed inside a vacuum tube. One metal is subjected to light and is called the emitter plate. The electrons that are ejected are called photoelectrons. The photoelectrons travel from the emitter plate to the other metal plate, which is called the collector plate. The two plates are externally connected with an electrical wire, and the current that flows through the wire can be measured with an ammeter. Philip Leonard, a student of Hertz, found that a higher current is produced when the intensity of light is increased. A higher current means that more photoelectrons are produced. A variable voltage source in series with the ammeter allows us to cause the photoelectrons to speed up or slow down. What does a positive voltage on the collector plate do? Since electrons are negatively charged, a positively charged collector plate would attract the photoelectrons and cause them to speed up. Conversely, a negatively charged collector plate would repel photoelectrons and slow them down. That is why a negative voltage applied on the collector plate is called an opposing voltage. If the opposing voltage is negative enough, the photoelectrons will turn around before making it to the collector plate, and no current will register in the ammeter. The smallest opposing voltage needed to stop the current is called the stopping voltage. If negative X is the stopping voltage, then we can say that the kinetic energy of the most energetic photoelectrons is X electron volts. What is the kinetic energy of a photoelectron if it requires an opposing voltage of negative 0.500 volts to prevent it from reaching the collector? The kinetic energy is positive 0.500 electron volts, or 8.01 times 10 to the negative 20 joules. Robert Millikan found that the maximum kinetic energy of the photoelectrons depends on the frequency of the light, but not on the intensity. For example, if a 350 nanometer radiation requires a stopping voltage of negative 1.20 volts, what stopping voltage would be required if you double the intensity? For as long as you're using the same wavelength, you're using the same frequency. It wouldn't matter how intense the radiation is, the stopping voltage would be the same, negative 1.20 volts. Remember that the stopping voltage tells us what the kinetic energy of the most energetic photoelectrons are. A stopping voltage of negative 1.20 volts means that the most energetic photoelectrons have a kinetic energy of 1.20 electron volts. This observation was puzzling. The reason is that for electromagnetic waves, a higher intensity means more energy. As we have seen earlier in Leonard's experiment, more electrons are able to gain energy with higher intensity. But for each electron, there appears to be a cap in how much energy it can gain. Millikan also found that, depending on the material used for the emitter, there is a minimum frequency needed for photoelectrons to be produced. We use the symbol nu naught to represent this threshold frequency. For example, suppose the threshold wavelength is 350 nanometers. Would you expect electrons to be ejected at 360 nanometers? The answer is no, because a 360 nanometer wavelength would correspond to a lower frequency than a 350 nanometer wavelength. The threshold frequency is a minimum. Since wavelength and frequency are inversely proportional, the threshold wavelength is a maximum. Millikan found that a plot of the maximum kinetic energy of photoelectrons versus frequency is a straight line. With kinetic energy on the y-axis and frequency on the x-axis, here's what a plot of experimental data would look like. Regardless of the material used for the emitter, the slope is always the same. It's Planck's constant. It's the same value that Planck found when he tried to explain blackbody radiation. Planck's constant, showing up in two very different phenomena, suggests that it is a universal constant. Now, the intercepts depend on the material used as emitter. The x-intercept is the threshold frequency, nu naught, and if you extrapolate the line to the y-axis, the y-intercept is equal to negative h times nu naught. This is the equation of the line. If we compare this with y equals mx plus b, we can identify ke as y, nu as x, h as the slope, and negative h times nu naught as the y-intercept. The equation can also be written this way. Here, h times nu naught is represented by the Greek letter phi. Phi is called the work function. Here's what data for another material might look like. Note that it will have the same slope, but the threshold frequency is different. The x and y intercepts will be different. In 1905, Einstein provided an explanation for the puzzling observations in the photoelectric effect experiments. For this, he won the 1921 Nobel Prize in Physics. Here's a summary of Einstein's explanation. First, we assume that the energy of light is only available in bundles or packets, which we now refer to as photons. The energy of each photon is equal to h times nu, where h is Planck's constant. There is a minimum energy that is needed to dislodge an electron from the surface of a metal. This minimum energy is equal to h times nu naught, where nu naught is the threshold frequency for the metal. Recall that h times nu naught is also called the work function, which we represent by the Greek letter phi. Photons behave like particles colliding with electrons. When a photon collides with an electron and its energy happens to be less than phi, then it won't be able to dislodge the electron from the surface. However, if the photon energy is higher than phi, then an electron will be freed from the surface. The electron absorbs the energy of the photon, part of the energy is used to escape the surface, and the remaining amount of energy becomes the electron's kinetic energy. In other words, the kinetic energy of the electron is the difference between the photon energy and the work function. This is the equation of the line that fits Millikan's experimental data. Higher intensity simply means more photons. For as long as the photon energies are big enough, more photons will cause more electrons to be ejected. If the photon energies are not big enough, it doesn't matter how many photons collide with the electrons will not be dislodged from the metal. Here's one analogy that you might find helpful. Imagine photons as bullets. You can toss a million bullets at a concrete wall, but you can't get a chip off the wall because none of the bullets have enough energy. But you can fire one bullet with a gun, and that single bullet can get a chip off the wall because it has enough energy. The bullet fired with a gun would be analogous to a high-frequency photon. One that is tossed by hand would be analogous to a low-frequency photon. A 300 nanometer radiation has a photon energy of 4.134 electron volts. Aluminum has a work function of 4.08 volts. What happens if we shine light with a wavelength of 300 nanometers on an aluminum metal? We can see that the photon energy, 4.134 electron volts, is higher than the energy needed to dislodge the electron, which is given as 4.08 electron volts. Therefore, an electron will be ejected and the kinetic energy of the electron will be the difference between the photon energy and the energy needed to dislodge it from the metal. 4.134 electron volts minus 4.08 electron volts gives us 0.054 electron volts. The extra energy of 0.054 electron volts becomes the kinetic energy of the electron. We can convert it to joules, and we get 8.7 times 10 to the negative 21 joules. We can also calculate the speed of the electron. Recall that kinetic energy is equal to 1 half times mass times the square of the speed. The mass of an electron is 9.1 times 10 to the negative 31 kilograms. We can rearrange the equation for kinetic energy to solve for the speed v, and we get v equals the square root of 2 times the kinetic energy divided by the mass of the electron. Plugging in the kinetic energy and the mass of the electron, we get an electron speed of 1.4 times 10 to the fifth meters per second.